They say when you're going to kill yourself, that there's certain triggers that will trigger you to finally have enough courage to do it. And those triggers that I had, there was three specific triggers, and two of them were coming true. I think I was going to end up going with right here. I grew up, actually, this is funny, I grew up hating police. I detested the police. I ended up having a kid, my oldest daughter, at 22, and I just felt like my life is just dead set. I'm making $8 an hour. I'm got this criminal record now, and I'll just be in this warehouse for the rest of my life. I still hate the police, but I seen an ad in the newspaper, and it said all you needed was a high school diploma. So I was like, this is better than working in this sweaty warehouse. So I applied. And when I started, it was really mind-blowing to me. They've treated me really bad at the academy. That's kind of how the ball got rolling in my police job, and it never really got any better. And and if your heart's not in it and you don't know how to deal with being a cop, it is about as volatile as anything that you'll ever come across. The fact that you see so much death, the fact that you're running across people I grew up with, now they hate me. Family members that I came up with and that I loved, they turn on you. I remember getting my tire slashed. I remember getting death threats. I remember one person I grew up with, he told my daughter, I remember that. He told my daughter, I'm gonna end up shooting your daddy. I've seen friends I know for decades, seeing them die in front of me. Going through all of that, I didn't know the Lord. I handled it. How I handled my stress was booze and being a heathen. I would come in and guys would say, well, I did this weekend. And I wanted to be the one who said, well, I was with three different women and I did this and that. I wanted to set the bar and like make all these clowns look like nothing, like I was the top animal. You suddenly get in this fog. It's depression is what it is, but you get in this fog where you really can't function daily without this darkness. It just got worse every day. I would drink it away, but then I couldn't sleep. The only thing I could do was this crazy cocktail of Ambien. I remember Xanaxes. I remember Trazodones. It was this crazy cocktail. And what I would do was I wouldn't drink water to wash it down. I would wash down with NyQuil. And this was just to get some sleep. And this was like a daily routine. And eventually I started thinking to myself, I wanted out of this crazy world because I knew I'd ruined my kids' lives. I knew I'd ruined every relationship I'd ever tried to have. And so that went on for years, maybe a couple of two, 3 years. And then I was like, you know what, screw it. I'm just come up with a plan to kill myself. I went to Walmart and I just sat there. There was nothing to do. It was one of them January nights where the wind was howling off the lake. It was 20 below wind chill. Nobody, absolutely nobody was out. And I remember specifically for some weird reason, I'm just counting the teardrops hit my leg. And I'm just going over my head that like, man, this is crazy, but this has to happen. I'm sitting there crying to myself and I'm in the parking lot. And all of a sudden I see this lady walking in the parking lot. So she knocks on my window and I'm like, I turn like this. And I just roll my window down just a crack. She just reaches her hand to the door and she hands me something. And she just said, you need this. And I go like this, I look at it and it's just a red cross. And she just turned around and walked away. And didn't explain herself. It was the most surreal moment of my life. I remember just looking down at it and I kind of clenched it in my hand. And I just screamed. I just screamed out. I was like, God, I know you're there. I'm gonna die. Can you do something? I will never forget that feeling that of him answering me. I had never in my life felt a presence of something like that before. I just remember feeling this peace, like there was just this presence with me. And I to this day, I don't remember if it was audible or in my head, or I just remember hearing Jesus say, he said, I'll forgive you. He said, stop what you're doing and follow me. I had never felt, it was almost as if I was floating. Like I'd never felt that much of a peace. And it was almost like all that darkness that was hovering over me, it just kind of like, it's like the clouds cleared a little bit and I felt a peace for the first time and since I knew. I'd never felt a peace like that. And I just felt safe. So I knew that this was real. People are gonna think I'm crazy. This is like the weirdest thing that's ever happened, but this just happened to me.
So the night that happened, it was a midnight shift. And when you're in here, it was like probably about 1 or 2 in the morning. And I remember I just sat in park, cause it's just lonely in here. And it's so cold during our Januaries. And there's like maybe 2 cars parked over there. And this whole lot is just empty. So there's really, when it's a slow night at work, I just come in and I park there. Cause a lot of times I'll walk in. That's the only place that's open here, 24 hours. So a lot of times I'll walk in to get a Gatorade or something. So that was where I parked, right in that fire lane right there. And when you're alone in your squad, there's so much solitude and all you have is your thoughts. And at the time, I was so like gone in the mind and all I had was shame and guilt that I was just ready to end. Like all I dwelt on. And I parked there and I'm just sitting there thinking about everything, going over what I was about to do and crying to myself. And this whole lot was just dead empty. There was nobody here. I had been there, it was a while. I'd say 20 minutes, half hour, just sitting there. And that shows you how slow it was because I'm just sitting there alone, crying to myself in the car. And that's when I seen. It was like in the middle of the lot, it was coming from right over there. That lady, it was so cold out and the wind was just gusting because you can tell the wind factors by the way that her hair was because she had long straight hair and it was like this way. And I seen her just slowly trekking through the lot. And then that was when she came over here that's the only door that's open at night, so there wasn't even an entrance over here. So that's why I thought I was safe from anyone bugging me. So she walks all the way, made her way all the way back over there for reasons unknown to me at the time. And she knocked on my window. And right in the middle of my probably the lowest point I was ever at, right in the middle of it. That's when God showed up and she knocked on the window and handed me that cross right in the middle of all of that. And things ain't been the same for me ever since. They say when you see things through different eyes. And when I met God that night, it's indescribable. It really is a supernatural thing. You can't believe scripture without, you can't leave the supernatural out of scripture. And that's what happened when you become a new creation. Like 2 Corinthians says, it's very much supernatural. I've never been the same since that day. And it will forever go down as an eternal moment for me. It was when I became justified, right there, 100 yards that way. And I remember just crying. I probably sat there for 45 minutes afterwards, crying, screaming out to God. And then I remember doing a big U-turn right over here, and I drove that way. And I believe the cemetery, don't say this is good, kind of sound a little dark, but it's not. But the cemetery is even more lonely, so I had to pull in there so I can cry some more. Nobody goes in a cemetery at night, so I was safe in that little parking lot. And I just wept and cried and contemplated my life and was shocked by what just happened. And I knew that moment that I met the Lord and that something was, that this was a moment in my life that was, I was going to change forever. And after that, as soon as the sun came up, I got a hold of my sister. I called her. I was like, man, something happened to me. I need to get in there and talk to whatever your pastor's name is. Because I never heard of him, didn't know who it was. That was the first thing that came to my mind. And I got in with Pastor George that next day. And life has been a crazy journey ever since then.
Coming in and telling people that I don't want to live like that anymore, it's tough. Just really was just telling the guys that having to walk away from a lot of conversations, having to not go where you used to go, having to get rid of a lot of things that you had. It was It was hard at first, but then people realize that it's real when you speak about it enough. I was very vocal that I didn't tell them how, but it wasn't until about a year and a half later when I publicly spoke on it for the first time. But I just told them something happened and that ain't me no more. It's hard. I guess it's hard in the temporal, but like in reality, in my heart, I'm like, I know what happened. I met the Lord. Like, I'll never go back to being that mad again. So here, I kind of was mentored under my pastor for like a year. He was like, you know, a lot of people are interested in you know so many people. I mean, when you're a cop, you're like a little mini celebrity in whatever city you're in. And so you're almost like a public figure. So he was like, he was after me. You got kids, why don't you start a youth group? Eventually, I caved and I told my son, oh, you know what, there's some basketball hoops at the gym. Tell a few of your friends to come and I'll buy you Little Caesars and then I'll read a verse to you or something. Because we're in a church, I got to read a verse to you. And pretty soon, those 6 kids turned to 10 kids, turned to 15 kids. And then they all looked at me in a certain way because I was a cop. And it was weird because I hated being a cop. I felt like being a cop is what almost killed me and what led me down this terrible dark path and gave me all these temptations and made my ego like this. So I really detested my badge. But then I realized early into that, man, God, you really just showed me that I can use everything that I hated about that and use it to glorify you with. Once we had like 15, 20 kids, I'd go around the city. Kids are arrested. Like, hey, what are you doing on Fridays? We got this little crew going. So literally, I would just go fishing. We've had murderers, armed robbers, dope dealers, old school gangsters come, like older guys getting out of prison. They come and they, I've heard of you. I appreciate what you do. And I don't even talk to police. But I mean, we have kids that come in there that won't even shake my hand because I'm the police, but they want the food and they want a hoop. So we have, and you have to answer every single question that they come with. And you have to learn how to love every one of them because I don't care what you did. I couldn't even begin to tell you how many people that the Lord has touched. And I never want to take credit for this stuff. I'm just like, I give all the glory to God. I'm just a moron that still struggles in his day-to-day life. We consider ourselves missionaries right here. And the importance of what's going on, especially in my city in Zion and Waukegan, and we got North Chicago kids now that come. The strife and just the lack of knowledge of the gospel, it's mind-blowing. It's so important and it's so easy because it's right here in front of us. And every kid matters. When you see a young person that was a potential killer give their life to the Lord, stand in a baptismal, tears streaming down his eyes, and you're a cop, someone that they're supposed to hate, it's like you just look up and like, God, I gotta pinch myself right now. So we try to get a personal relationship with every kid that comes in. When you lose one, it's like losing your own child. This is one of my top soldiers right here. I wear him around my neck. He died a year and a half ago. But to know that everyone that walked in them doors saw the love of Christ. They felt Jesus. They were given the truth. To know that you've been able to be an ambassador and a mouthpiece for God is right here. The need is so great.
It's repentance. Repentance. I was living this way. I'm following this line. This was my line. Straight to hell. I met God. Repentance literally means change directions. Oh God, I'm chasing you. I'm going towards you. I found out who Jesus was. He's our only hope to make us clean, to get into heaven. So challenge yourself there. That's all we ask. I love you guys. Let's pray.
If we don't tell them, and we don't be intentional, or we're not intentional about doing this, are we just going to watch them drown? That's what keeps me going. I mean, that's what I feel all goes back to why God kicked me in the butt that day and said, go. And that's my mission.
You know they scared me to death this week, man. I heard what hit you in the elbow?
Yeah. It broke my arm. Broke my whole arm.
Man, I'm so glad that you're okay.
It happened so fast. It was just like, we was just trying to see my boy because he finna leave to go to the military. Mm-hmm. And so we were just chilling and cooling with him. Next thing you know, bullets just started flying. Like 40 shots went off. It was like at least 40 shots that went off.
Yeah. And you're very, very loved, man.
Yeah.
And we got you back no matter what.
Yeah, but you definitely will still see me in there Friday.
Yeah. You ain't gonna change. I wanna see you dunk with a cast on.
I got you.
I love you, Frank.
I'm known as this weirdo cop now that runs this organization that's always talking about saving kids or saving people. The biggest benefit to me, and that's for really any follower of Christ, to me is like every day. It's like you have the potential of, as an ambassador for Jesus, you have the potential of somebody's eternity could change. Like, there's nothing better. So every week, when I'm doing halftime or I'm teaching or getting personal with the kids, that's the biggest benefit to me, is the spiritual benefit. Like, you could change in eternity. We've sat down, rivals on the street. We've squashed street beefs. We've been blessed. Now we do drives, and we get the community has really rallied around us, so we can financially help out a lot of kids that wouldn't have anything. There is some heartbreak that goes with it, though. When you lose kids, when you see, I've literally had to lock up some of my own kids. Had to bury quite a few of my own kids. So there's a downside to it. But you know, you did it, and they know the truth. They've heard the truth. I've seen their lives be the story. I've seen one of my kids right here. He died leaving MFB. And his death brought so many people to the knowledge of what God can do. Because we didn't think he was listening to a word we said, but the entire time God was working. So even just by that tragedy, we got so much outpouring of people that story just touched. And then we got we got some soldiers that they wear that logo with pride. Like, our shirts are all over the city. The job is never done. I have 4 more years of my career. We plan on doing this full time after I retire. I just know we have to. There's so much work to be done because there's so many kids. We see new faces every week. And that's even outside of our building, I see it at work every day. I see how lost this world is right now. And it's because everything is the social media. This is the social media generation, so I can look on my timeline and say, this is so needed. And you just never know when you're gonna run into that unlikely kid. And it's the most unlikely ones that are the most powerful stories. I say this work is never done. That's one of my mottos. To my last breath, I'll keep doing this.
His life, him personally, he was my father figure. I didn't grow up with a dad. And like I said, when I met him, he was that. Just, you know, outside of this, checking in, making sure I was good. I eventually moved in with him at one point.
You could be doing anything on a Friday, and you, like, this is a commitment, you know, to come here every Friday. So what keeps you coming back?
For me, just me trying to be the leader. A lot of the kids in there don't want to admit that, you know, they need Jesus. A lot of them are probably scared. Maybe they think it's lame, but for me, I just want to be that you know, that leader that's showing them every week that, you know, this is what's cool. A lot of your friends might think it's not, but eventually we are all gonna die, no question. And the life after is really what we need, what we gotta strive for, and that's just what I'm trying to do.
Right.
Change lives, just like him.
It's repentance. I was living this way, I'm following this line, this was my line, straight to hell. I met God. Repentance literally means change directions. Oh God, I'm chasing you. I'm going towards you. I found out who Jesus was. He's our only hope to make us clean.
to get into heaven. So challenge yourself there. That's all we ask. I love you guys. Let's pray.
If you are a follower of Christ, I want to know, what else do you have to do other than to be an ambassador for him and try to save other souls? One of my biggest inspirations, when I was growing up, my mom listened to Keith Green. It's from a song called Asleep in the Light. Like, he's like challenging, like, do you see all these people sinking down? Don't you care? Are you just gonna let them drown, is what he's saying. And one of the things that he says, and I like I would love to, in a loving way, challenge every Christian. He says in that song, he says, bless me, Lord, bless me, Lord. You know, that's all I ever hear. So no one aches, no one hurts, no one even sheds one tear. But he cries, he weeps, he bleeds, and he cares for your needs. And he's, don't just lay back and soak that in. Every 2 seconds on earth, somebody dies, and somebody's standing in judgment. But to realize that every person that you pass, is he saved? Does he know Christ? And if not, what are we in this for our own comfort? Get uncomfortable. That's my challenge. You don't have to be a preacher. I had no clue what I was doing when I started this. I just knew that our main objective, what did they ask Jesus? What's the two biggest commandments? Love God, love each other. How hard is it to love somebody? To be there for them? We have Christians and old 80-year-old people that would have nothing to, like, we have like senior citizen with a Four Corner Hustler, which is our local gang. They don't know anything about each other, but that Christian will just love them. They'll be there for them. Oh, you need a slice of pizza? Yeah. You need something? You okay? You need something to drink? How you doing? A handshake. Like, that's all, that's showing the love of Christ. And it's not hard. That's what I would challenge you. Get out there. Because what is more important than someone's soul?
Do you see?
Hey!
Do you see?
What's up?
I can see you guys coming from a mile away. What you guys doing?
Don't you care? Don't you care? Are you gonna let them drown? How can you be so numb not to care if they come? You close your eyes and pretend the job's done. Oh, bless me, Lord, you know it's all I ever hear. No one aches, no one hurts, no one even sheds one tear. But he cries, he weeps, he bleeds.